Yeah. Jesus, at the center of it. Good morning, Church. Welcome to Praise Baptist Center online service. Let us be reminded of our vision statement, Go and make disciples, and our mission statement, rooted in the Word, sharing the gospel. Online prayer meetings are on Wednesdays, 8:30 p.m., and online life groups are on Thursdays, 8:30 p.m. Information regarding tithes and offerings have been provided in the PBC official chat group. If you need more information, please feel free to contact Sister Fong Ping. Today's speaker is Pastor Gary Hemrick from Cornerstone Chapel, Virginia, USA. He is the senior pastor and one of the founding members who planted this church in 1991. Currently, he is on the advisory board for the Museum of the Bible and also serves as the chief chaplain for the Loudoun County Sheriff's Office. He has been married to Terry since 1987, and they have three grown children who also serve in ministry and five grandchildren. Today, he will be speaking to us from the book of Jude. Thank you for listening, and may you be blessed by the message today.
Well, let's pray first. Father, it's good to be in your house, and it's good in the middle of the week just to settle our hearts before you and to just kind of recalibrate things, just to get our hearts right. And Lord, to just regain a perspective of what is right according to your word. And we live in very difficult days in terms of just how culture has become so relative, and people don't really understand truth as it is. And so we thank you that we hold in our hands, that we have on our laps, your word of truth. And we pray that it would guide us and direct us and give us wisdom and change us, Lord. Shape us to be more like Jesus, our Savior. And we thank you for the book of Jude. As we go through it, Lord, just guide us by your Holy Spirit. Give us understanding. And we just love you and we praise you for the chance to be together in your house tonight. We thank you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. All right, as always, a little background. This is obviously a tiny book, only 25 verses, so we'll get through the whole book this evening, Lord willing. But here's a little background on the book of Jude. The writer is Jude, but that's actually a contracted form of his proper name, which is Judas. And he is the half-brother of Jesus, and he is the brother of James. If you notice in chapter 1, verse 1, it says, Jude, a bondservant of Jesus Christ and brother of James. Now, the reason that he's making this distinction is because Judas, his real name, is obviously another well-known name, and Judas Iscariot was one of the 12 of the original apostles that Jesus selected. And so this Judas, otherwise known as Jude, it's kind of like Robert is known as Bob, okay? So this Judas wants you to know, I'm not that Judas. I'm not Judas Iscariot. I am a bondservant of Jesus. And it's interesting, he doesn't use the family card. You know, he doesn't say, you know, Jesus is my half-brother. He calls himself a bondservant. It's the Greek word doulos. He is an indentured servant. He has decided willfully to be a slave to Jesus Christ. And he doesn't play the family card here for any kind of privilege or status, but he does let us know that he is the brother of James. And Jesus had four brothers. They were all half-brothers, obviously. They all share the same mother, not the same father. Jesus' father is God, and the father of his brothers was Joseph. But in Mark chapter 6, verse 3, it tells us the names of Jesus' four half-brothers. They are Judas, this guy here, Jude, Joseph, Simon, and James. And it tells us in Mark 6:3 that Jesus also had sisters, plural, but they're not mentioned by name. So we know he had at least two sisters, and he had the four brothers who are mentioned by name. So he had six siblings, himself being the seventh child, Mary and Joseph making nine in the family. And you have to remember that back in those days, homes were really, really tiny. And so to have nine people in the same home in those days was crowded space, to say the least. But this is the brother, the half-brother of Jesus. Now, Jude was not chosen as one of Jesus's original apostles. And neither was James, his other half-brother. But this James here, this brother of Jude, is the same James who wrote the epistle of James, the epistle of James. And the Bible says that all of Jesus' family at first, I guess with the exception of Mary, and we don't really know much about what Joseph believed or thought concerning Jesus, except during the time of his birth. But Joseph fades off the pages of the Bible after Jesus is at the age of 12 in the temple area, and we don't hear of Joseph again. It is believed that he passes away. He's probably much older than Mary was. But the Bible does say that his siblings did not believe in him as the Messiah, not at first. They will later believe in him, as you will see here, Jude obviously does, and James does, who wrote the Epistle of James. The one who wrote the Epistle of James, James becomes a leader in the New Testament church. In Acts chapter 15, James is consulted as one of the leaders of the early church. And so his siblings will eventually come around. And this is one of them, his half-brother Judas here, or better known as Jude. The date of this writing is unknown because there's nothing specific that ties it to any particular event. So scholars give it a time period of somewhere between 65 and 80 AD. There are two main themes in the book of Jude, and here they are. Number one, he writes to expose false teachers. And number two, he writes to encourage believers to contend for the faith and to finish strong. Now, he's going to tell us in the first couple of verses that was not his original intent. He's going to tell us that his original intent was just to write to fellow believers about their common salvation, to just kind of write about how good it is to know Jesus as Savior and to experience salvation and to be Christians and to share camaraderie as believers. But he's going to change. He says, I found it more necessary to exhort you, because he saw something dangerous in the early church. And so he addresses first false teachers and he exposes them, and he's going to expose them heavily. And then he's going to also encourage believers to contend for the faith and finish strong. So I'm going to point out to you just a few of the different terms, not all of them, but a few of the different terms in just 25 verses that Jude uses to describe these false teachers. And you'll see it as we go through, but I just wanted to kind of pull them out so we could see what he thinks of these false teachers. Let there be no mistake, he didn't like them. And so he calls them ungodly in verse 4, dreamers in verse 8. In other words, they're not in touch with reality. He calls them spots or blemishes in verse 12. He calls them waterless clouds, just big puffy things that don't ever produce any rain. He calls them fruitless trees also in verse 12, because, you know, you will know people by their fruit. And he says these false teachers, you can spot them as false because they have no fruit, nothing legitimate. And he calls them raging waves in verse 13, and he calls them wandering stars also. So he uses different terms to just describe them. But probably the worst of the language concerning these false teachers is at the end of verse 13. If you just glance ahead in your Bibles at the end of verse 13, he says, for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Now, that is a very nice way of saying they're going to hell. Because Jesus said three times in the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew 8:12, Matthew 22:13, Matthew 25:30, that one of the things that describes hell is outer darkness. Outer darkness. It's interesting, you know, the Bible also speaks about unquenchable flames, but yet the unquenchable flames must not put off light, because at the same time that the Bible describes hell as having unquenchable flames, it also says that it is a place of outer darkness. Outer darkness. You know, the thing about darkness is it leaves someone feeling completely isolated. Completely isolated. It is a terrible thing to be in the dark. Jude says about these guys, they're ungodly dreamers, spots, waterless clouds, fruitless trees, raging waves, wandering stars, and blackness of darkness has been reserved for them forever. So he pronounces, you know, judgment upon these guys because they're not being true to doctrine. They're misleading people. They are distorting the truth of God's word. They are not representing Jesus. And again, Jude doesn't play the family card, but he knows Jesus, right? He grew up with Jesus. Now, that would be wonderful on the one hand and tough on the other hand, wouldn't it? You know, because there would probably be the tendency, I don't know this, obviously it's not in the Bible, but you know, so Mary and Joseph, let's give them the benefit of the doubt. But in a lot of families, I could just hear, you know, the parents like, you know, why can't you clean up your room like Jesus? I mean, seriously, why can't you ever, you know, can't you do your schoolwork? Look at Jesus get straight A's. What's wrong with you? You know, so it was probably a delight and probably some, which might be the reason why his half-brothers and sisters didn't at first believe in him. Like, yeah, we grew up with him. Yeah, we could never live up to Jesus, you know. And so, but eventually they got over that. And they love him and receive him as and accept him as Messiah. And so Jude doesn't have anything good here to say about these false teachers. And he's going to expose them all through this letter. And then he's also going to, particularly at the end, encourage believers to contend for the faith and to finish strong. You know, it does not really matter what kind of a start you got. What matters is how well you finish. Some of you came to know Christ at a very young age, and some of you came to know Christ later in your life. And I hear people from time to time talk about how I wish I'd come to know Christ earlier in life because I regret some of the things before I knew Jesus. And okay, you know what? You got out of the blocks a little bit late on the start, but it doesn't matter. What matters is how you finish. And God is the redeemer of lives. And God can take broken people and make them whole. And God can give us a hope and a future and obviously salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. And so Jude is going to say here, finish well, finish strong. You may not have gotten the best start, but finish well and finish strong. So let's take a look here in chapter 1 here, verse 1, and where he says, Jude, a bondservant of Jesus Christ and brother of James. I'm going to put back the main themes again so we can keep focused on that. To those who are called, sanctified by God the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ. Now circle those three words, called, sanctified, preserved. Called, sanctified. Some of your Bibles, some translations say beloved instead of sanctified. I'll take either one. I love the love of the Lord, and I need to be sanctified by the Lord. Called, sanctified, and preserved. That word preserved, he's going to begin his letter and end his letter in the same way. He says that we are preserved in Jesus Christ. Some of your Bibles say we are kept in Jesus Christ. I want you to notice the way the epistle ends in verse 24, where he gives thanks to the Lord. And he says, now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. He speaks there in verse 24 about God being able to keep us. He begins the letter here in verse 1 saying to God, by God the Father, and preserved or kept in Jesus Christ. And it's an encouraging word for us to remember. God is a keeping God. God is a keeping God. The Bible says in different places, like Philippians 1:6, this is what Paul meant when he said, he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus, because God is a keeping God. Paul would also say in 1 Corinthians 1:8, that God will keep you strong to the end so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is a keeping God. Paul would write to Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:12, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day. God is a keeping God. And even in the Old Testament, the great priestly blessing of Numbers chapter 6 says, the Lord bless you and keep you, and the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you, and the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. God is a keeping God. God is actively at work helping us to persevere. And so Jude begins his letter by saying, God is a keeping God in verse 1. God is a keeping God in verse 24. These are like bookends to his epistle, but a good reminder to us that God will help us to finish this race. He will help us to finish strong. And then in verse 2, the common salutation of the New Testament writers, mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Be multiplied to you. He says, "Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation." So here's where he's going to tell us. Hey, this my intent was to write you just a charming letter rejoicing about our common salvation. Now, he doesn't mean common as in cheap, like it's everyday common. He means common in it's mutual. He says, "I had intended to write to you about our mutual salvation, our common faith, but," he says, "I found it necessary to write to you exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints." Now, in your Bibles there, contend earnestly is one word in the Greek, and it is the only time this particular Greek word is used in all of the New Testament, and the word is epagonizomei, and in the, you try that three times. And in the middle of that word, epagonizomei, is where we get our English word agonize, epagonizomei. And so the idea is to fight, to agonize, to labor, contend earnestly for the faith. Now, it isn't in the sense like you have to earn it, you know, work for salvation. Salvation's already been gained for you. Okay, we receive it through faith. It's a gift from God. It's by grace that we're saved. But it's the idea that now that we are saved, we're in this for the long haul. So fight for your faith. Stay strong in the Lord. Don't grow weary. Don't get weak. Don't check out. We talked about on Sunday. Don't become complacent. Don't become apathetic in your faith. Fight. Agonize. Labor. Because why? It's important. You fight for what's important. You fight for the things that are valuable. Your faith is valuable. It's supremely valuable. So he's challenging us. Fight. Fight for your faith. Don't allow the influence of evil to overcome you. But fight for the faith. And he's going to tell us in a few verses here examples of people who lost. People who gave in to the evil influence of their day. So he challenges us here, he exhorts us. He said, I wanted to write this wonderful letter about our common salvation, but instead I find myself overwhelmed here. I have to exhort you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. Verse 4, "For certain men," here's this idea about the false teachers, "for certain men have crept in unnoticed." Please note that. NIV says they've secretly slipped in among you. You know, false teachers are not going to say, "Hi, my name is so-and-so. I'm a false teacher." They sneak in secretively. So, you know, it's always, I throw this caution out every once in a while. It's important. You don't take my word for it. You search what Scripture says. You don't take some TV evangelist's word for it. You search Scriptures to see what the Bible says. You don't read a Christian book and just take it at face value. You pass it through the grid of God's word. We have to make sure that we're testing things because false teachers don't announce themselves. They come in secretly. They come in, they crept in unnoticed. Who, verse 4, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation? Ungodly men who turned the grace of our God into lewdness. And it, you know, a lot of times lewdness we think in terms of sexuality, but it just basically means a brazen practice. The corruption of doctrine is a brazen practice. That's what he means by lewdness. He says, "Who turned the grace of our God into lewdness and denied the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ." Verse 5, "But I want to remind you," and he's going to give us examples here. "I want to remind you, though you once knew this, that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe." So, he's going to give us three examples here. Now he's talking here about encouraging believers to contend for the faith and to finish strong. And he's going to give three examples of people who didn't finish well, of people who didn't fight for the faith. Now, he's going to draw on Old Testament examples because that's what he has, the Jewish Scriptures. I mean, in the first century, you didn't have the completion of the New Testament. You're still relying on the Scripture of the Old Testament. And so the Tanakh, the whole of God's word from Genesis to Malachi. And so he's going to draw on three examples from the Old Testament of those who allowed evil to influence them And they didn't stand strong in the faith. They didn't stand strong in the Lord. And so the first one that he points out here in verse 5, reminding us, though you once knew this, the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe. So the first example he gives is the Israelites in the wilderness. And this account, of course, is all through the book of Exodus and recounted again in the book of Numbers. And it's this whole wilderness wandering thing for 40 years when God had delivered the Jewish slaves out of slavery in Egypt, and that by itself was a series of miracles to eventually get Pharaoh reluctantly to let the Hebrew slaves go. And God takes them to the Promised Land, and there they are on the border of the Promised Land, and Moses sends in 12 spies, and two come back with a good report. The others have a bad report. And the two that had a good report were Caleb and Joshua. And all the others had a bad report. Oh, there's giants in the land. We can't go in there. They're going to consume us. I don't know. You know, we've come this far, but, you know, I don't think that we're going to be victorious, and maybe we made a big mistake. And they spread fear throughout the whole camp of the Israelites. And before you know it, all along the way, the Israelites have been grumbling and complaining about this and that. And now this was just like the straw that broke the camel's back, because now they're like, well, if there are giants in the land, and if this doesn't look like some place that we can take and occupy, then what are we doing out here in the wilderness? And they start complaining to God. Like, we can't go in there. It would have been better if we had gone back to Egypt. We would be better off back in Egypt. And so God's like, okay, you want Egypt? Okay. You're right here in the Sinai Peninsula. Why don't you just hang out here for 40 more years? And for 40 years, that entire generation would wander in the Sinai Peninsula until they would eventually die off. And only their children would go into the Promised Land, plus Joshua and Caleb, the two spies who had the favorable report because they believed God. Besides Joshua and Caleb, an entire generation of the Israelites would die in the wilderness. Why? Because they did not believe God. And they did not stand for what was right and true. And they allowed evil influence to take over their hearts and their minds. And they ended up dying in the wilderness. And God gave them what they really wanted. We don't want to go in there. Okay, fine, then you can die out here, and I'll take your children into the Promised Land. And that's exactly what he did. And so Jude draws on that example. He says, hey, remember the Jewish people. They came out of the land of Egypt. They started well, but they didn't finish well. And so they died in the wilderness. Verse 6, this is example number 2. And the angels, who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of the great day. So number 2, the second example that Jude gives here, is about the angels who rebelled with Satan. Again, they got off to a great start, but they didn't finish well because they allowed the influence of Satan to steal their hearts away from God. And what the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 12, actually, because the Bible's not necessarily in chronological order, and some of what we read in the book of Revelation actually predates things and goes back historically. And Revelation 12 talks about how Satan rebelled against God. And that day that he rebelled against God, he led a third of what the Bible calls stars, but it's a euphemism for angels. He led a third of the angels in rebellion with him in this great coup against God. Now, how many is a third of the angels? We don't know, because we don't know how many angels there actually are. But you're talking a lot. And the third of the angels who rebelled with Satan were expelled with him from heaven, otherwise known today as demons. Satan inspired them to rebel against God with him, and thus they were expelled. But what Jude is telling us here, and there's another story in Luke chapter 8 that backs all this up as well when you compare Scripture with Scripture. What Jude is telling us is that some of the worst of these demons have been kept in this chains, reserved in everlasting chains, under darkness for the judgment of the great day. Now, in Revelation chapter 12, it speaks about when they rebelled, but Revelation also tells us that there's going to come a time when God will open the lid of this abyss. And these demons will be allowed during the period of the Great Tribulation to come out and to torment people. It is actually by his grace that he has kept the worst of the demons presently under chains in the abyss. That isn't to say all demons are there, because there are plenty of demons who roam in the spirit realm. But the worst of the worst have been kept in the abyss in chains until that day of judgment, when God will use them in that period of the tribulation. Now, in Luke chapter 8, there's a story that many of you are familiar with, when Jesus goes to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, to the region of the Gadarenes, to cast out demons from this guy who had been possessed. And when Jesus confronts the demons in this man, he asks their name, and the demon says, Legion, for we are many. Now, a Roman legion was 6,000 soldiers. Were there 6,000 demons in this guy? I don't know. One is too many, right? One demon in somebody is one too many. But the reason you can't necessarily trust a demon is because demons lie. So it could have been one demon. It was like, oh, yeah, we're 6,000. Yeah, I got a legion. We have 6,000 demons. You don't know, because they're liars. So Jesus then, before he cast the demons out of this guy, they begged Jesus, the demons. Please, this is in Luke chapter 8. It's in verse 31. The demons begged Jesus, please send us into the herd of swine, but don't cast us into the abyss. They know the worst of the worst are held in the abyss. We don't want to go where they are. Even the demons don't want some of the bad demons. They're worse demons. We don't want to be with them. We don't hang out with them. So don't cast us, please, in the abyss. It's interesting. Jesus, in his mercy, even for demons, did not cast them into the abyss. Cast them into the herd of swine, which was a very strategic move on Jesus' part, because the Jews should not have had pigs anyway. They should not have. These were Hellenistic Jews. These were Jews who were influenced by the Greek culture. They should have been kosher. They should have been, you know, no pork at that time. Now, praise God, Jesus has declared all foods clean. So eat spare rib, pork barbecue ribs, pulled pork barbecue, bacon. Praise God, bacon makes everything good, friends. I don't care what kind of, if you're having a bad day, eat some bacon. It will make you feel, you say, Pastor Gary, it'll kill you. It'll just make you go to heaven quicker. It's fine. But in these days, you couldn't have pork, you couldn't have pigs. What were the Jews having pigs? So Jesus is like, I'm going to kill two birds with one stone. I'm going to deliver this guy from demons, and I'm going to kill the livelihood of these Jews who shouldn't even have pigs. But the abode that they abandoned was heaven. These angels left their abode. They left their proper domain, and they were influenced by Satan. And the Lord put these particular demons, the worst of the worst, in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of the great day. They started so well, but they didn't finish well. The third example he gives is verse 7. As Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, in a similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, NIV uses the word perversion, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. And so the third example he gives from the book of Genesis, Genesis 18 and 19, is the account of Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, most of you are familiar with what happened in Sodom and Gomorrah. And, you know, today, now as I talk about this subject, it is counter to what our culture is saying, because our culture has now embraced homosexuality as a quote, normal lifestyle, as just an alternative lifestyle, but the Bible has never seen it that way. In fact, in the book of Romans, God calls it unnatural. Again, NIV uses the word perversion. New King James here says it's going after strange flesh. This is not the way that God designed relationships to be. He designed a relationship between a man and a woman in a heterosexual relationship. And so Sodom and Gomorrah, God destroys, and he destroys them on the basis of their sexual sin. These were people who started out well, but they didn't finish well. And it was offensive to God. And so again, on a subject like this, where our country has legalized same-sex marriage, and where our culture has for the most part, embraced it as simply an alternative lifestyle. I have to be able to give grace and truth. And the grace is we love people who are in same-sex relationships or have same-sex attraction. The church is welcome to people of all kinds because we all are sinners in need of grace and forgiveness. But we also will not shy away from telling the truth because somebody said this to me one time and it always has stuck with me. They said to me, Gary, one of the highest forms of respect is to tell you the truth. And so I respect you enough to tell you the truth and that God's word has been unwavering on this subject, that homosexuality is a sin. And but praise God, he can forgive us, deliver us, transform us. And he in Jude here, he uses this as an example of those who allowed the evil influence of their day to take their hearts captive. All these three examples, again, to say this, Jude is saying, fight for the faith, earnestly contend for the faith, finish well, do not allow the evil of your day to influence you. This is what happened with the Israelites, this is what happened with the angels, this is what happened with the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. They allowed the evil of their day to influence them and to turn them away from God. So he gives us those examples. Then in verse 8, he says, likewise, also, these dreamers, here he is talking about these false prophets again, these false teachers, they defile the flesh, reject authority, and speak evil of dignitaries. Yet, verse 9, Michael, the archangel, in contending with the devil when he disputed about the body of Moses, dared not bring against him a reviling accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke you. Now, there in verse 9, Michael is mentioned here as the archangel. The word archangel is never mentioned in the plural. There's not another archangel mentioned in the Bible. This is the only archangel. Some people think Gabriel was an archangel. Gabriel was not an archangel. He was a messenger angel, but Michael is the only archangel mentioned in the Bible. He's mentioned four times, twice in the book of Daniel, Daniel 10, Daniel 12. He's also mentioned in Revelation chapter 12, and then here in Jude verse 9. So he gets four mentions in all of the Bible. And this is a peculiar verse, I will tell you. It's the whole idea of what does it mean that Michael the archangel was contending, fighting with the devil over the body of Moses? So this is the little that we know. The Bible says in Deuteronomy chapter 34 that Moses was not allowed to go into the promised land. Don't feel sorry for Moses because it's a beautiful picture, actually, where Moses represents the law. Joshua, his protege, is the one who will lead the people into the promised land. Joshua in Hebrew, it's a contracted form of the name Yahashua. It's the same name that Jesus was given. It is a picture of how the law can never take you into the promised land. It is only through Jesus that you will get there. Okay, it's a beautiful picture. But God took care of Moses. In Deuteronomy 34, 5 and 6, it says that Moses died and God buried him. So what Jude is telling us, a little bit of insight into what happened there during the time of Moses' death, that apparently Satan wanted to somehow take the body of Moses before God would bury it and mutilate it or disfigure it in some way to just, show contempt for Moses and to show contempt for God's people and for God's prophet. And so Michael, the archangel, steps in. So this is a scene that is not recorded anywhere else. Jude is giving us a little insight here that Michael the archangel steps in and fights with Satan over the body of Moses. But it's interesting here that that Jude says, even though Michael is this archangel, he doesn't go around, you know, sticking out his chest and thinking, I'm going to take the devil down. He actually defers and stands behind the name of the Lord and says, the Lord rebuke you. And I can remember before my pastor Chuck Smith died several years ago that he would always caution us as pastors, don't go around just rebuking Satan, rebuking Satan, rebuking Satan. He said, look at how even Michael the archangel dared not rebuke Satan to his face, but said, the Lord rebuke you. We have to be careful sometimes. And some people would say, well, wait a minute, you know, Michael doesn't walk in the same, you know, grace and power as a redeemed believer. Okay, I understand in terms of relationship with Christ, but I'm never going to mess with an archangel. I can tell you that much. And if an archangel, if the archangel dared not dispute with Moses, but instead he said, the Lord rebuke you. And he invoked the name of the Lord. We ought to be careful. Don't go around rebuking demons under every bush. Just stand in who Jesus is. And if you need to rebuke in the name of the Lord, say, "The Lord rebuke you." But we better know our place behind the name of the Lord. Verse 10. "But these speak evil of whatever they do not know, and whatever they know naturally, like brute beasts, in these things they corrupt themselves." Talking again about these false teachers. "Woe to them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, have run greedily in the error of Balaam for profit, and perished in the rebellion of Korah." So now what he's going to do is he's going to give three examples to indict these false teachers, and he's going to compare them in the Old Testament to Old Testament examples. And the first one he says here is like, they've taken the way of Cain. Now, Cain was the firstborn of Adam and Eve. His story is recorded in Genesis chapter 4. The Bible says that Cain tilled the ground. He was a man of the soil. It says that Abel, his younger brother, was a man of the flocks. And when it came time to offer, to present offering to the Lord, Abel brought an offering from the flocks. Cain brought an offering from the produce of the land. And God accepted Abel's sacrifice and rejected Cain's. Now, there's some debate. You know, why did he accept one and reject the other? Probably because Abel is presenting a blood sacrifice. It is an inference to us that God had already prescribed that the way that you get to me following sin, because they've been already expelled out of the Garden of Eden. Man has already sinned. The human race has already been tainted by sin. That the way you approach me is through the sacrifice of an animal. It's a blood sacrifice. And that's what Abel presented, and Cain did not. Cain did not follow God's prescriptive way to get to God. There's no other way to get to God except God's prescribed way. And in the Old Testament, God made a way possible through the sacrifice of animals. But then in the New Testament, Jesus comes, dies on a cross. That's why John the Baptist, when he saw Jesus coming to be baptized, said, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the earth, of the world." Because Jesus came as the perfect Lamb to offer his life as a sacrifice, replacing and fulfilling all the Old Testament sacrificial system. By his blood are we saved. By his stripes are we healed, you see. And so God had prescribed a method in the Old Testament until such time that Jesus could be revealed in the New Testament, and thus Jesus is the only way to be saved now. But that prescribed method was already active in Genesis chapter 4. And Cain did not bring the blood sacrifice. He brought, "I'm just going to give him what I want to give him. I'm going to give him the fruit of my own labor." No. That's works, Cain. You can't come to God by works. You have to come to God by the sacrifice. But in addition, in Hebrews chapter 11, Abel is mentioned as a man of faith, which infers to us that Abel presented his sacrifice by faith and Cain had unbelief. He didn't believe that this was a proper way to connect and commune with God. So Abel is commended for his faith, even though in the end, of course, tragically, Cain kills Abel. We know this. But that's one of the things that these false teachers are compared to. Cain exhibited self-righteousness. I can come in my own righteousness. I'm going to do it my way. I'm going to present my own offering here. I don't have to come God's prescribed way. That's self-righteousness. And so Jude is comparing these false teachers to the way of Cain, saying they're self-righteous. Then he compared there in verse 11 also to the error of Balaam. Now this story is in Numbers chapters 22 to 24, and it's when Balak, the king of Moab, was fighting with the Israelites and knew he was outmaneuvered because the Israelites had God on their side. And so Balak hires this kind of wacky prophet by the name of Balaam. "You come and you curse God's people, I will pay you." And in Numbers between chapters 22 and 24, one of those chapters, it says that they paid him the fee of divination. It was all about the money. So Balaam came for the money, and in fact, two words indicating money is found there in verse 11. You look back at your Bibles, they have run greedily, greed, in the error of Balaam for profit. So he's saying these false teachers were not in it with right motives, they were in it for the money. They would get money from people to do what they did. And perished, the third example, perished in rebellion of Korah. So the third example he draws from Numbers chapter 16. Korah was a leader among the Israelites. And Korah went to Moses one day, and basically, I'm paraphrasing number 16, but basically said, Moses, you know, I know you're selected by God, but, you know, you're not all that. We can hear from God, too, and, you know, even your sister Miriam, your brother Moses, you know, the three of you, listen, you're a little too full of yourselves. We need to have a share in leadership here. And, you know, God overhears this, and long story short, God says to Moses, tell Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, these are other cohorts in crime, tell them to come near to the tabernacle, and I'm going to speak to them. And so they all gather together, and when they're there the next day, God says to Moses, now, Moses, I just want you to step aside. Step aside, Moses. And Moses is like, why? Step aside. Step aside. Because I'm about to smoke these people. And the Bible says God opened up the earth and swallowed them. Okay, not a good way to go. Not a good way to go. But they were rebellious. And so Jude is saying these teachers here, they're self-righteous, they're greedy, they are rebellious. Verse 12. These are spots in your love feasts. They would have these agape feasts where they would break bread together, they would share communion. He says, these guys are, they're blemishes in your love feasts. While they feast with you without fear, serving only themselves, they are clouds without water, carried about by the winds, late autumn trees without fruit, twice dead, pulled up by the roots, raging waves of the sea, foaming up their own shame, wandering stars for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. I mean, you read this and you just want to stop and say, hey, Jude, don't make it bad. You know, anyway, but he's taking a sad song and he's going to make it better here. Just hang with me because he's going to make it better. It gets better here. But verse 14, he says, now Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men also, saying, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000 of his saints. This is speaking about the return of the Lord, Revelation 19, to execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have committed in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. So Jude refers to Enoch here as a prophet, which is unusual because we don't think of him necessarily as a prophet like that. But Enoch was a righteous man, and Enoch is mentioned also in Hebrews chapter 11. He walked with God, and God just took him. God just snatched him up bodily up to heaven. But Enoch spoke about judgment coming for false teachers. Verse 16, these are grumblers, complainers. You know, you get the idea what Jude thinks here, right, about all these people. Walking according to their own lusts, and they mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how they told you that there would be mockers in the last time who would walk according to their own ungodly lusts. These are sensual persons. Now, it doesn't mean, we think of sensual as sexual. It doesn't mean it that way in the context. He means these are people who rely on their senses. They're physically minded, not spiritually minded, who cause divisions, not having the Spirit. So he's even saying these people aren't even saved. And he says in verse 20, but you, beloved, now look here, verses 20 to 23, he's going to talk about here's our responsibility, and then he's going to tell us what God's going to do, what God's responsibility is, and what God says he will do. But here's our part, verse 20, but you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life, and on some have compassion, making a distinction, but others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh. So basically what he's saying to us here is, listen, we have a responsibility to build ourselves up in our most holy faith. It's important. Read your Bibles, pray, commune with God, connect with him, worship. You know, guard your hearts, guard your minds, guard your lives, build yourselves up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Now, there's different interpretations. What exactly does that mean, praying in the Holy Spirit? I believe that this particular passage is a little bit different. Romans 8:26 talks about how the Holy Spirit intercedes for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. Romans 8:26 is speaking about how there are times, and I think most, about all of us, can relate to this. There are times when you will be so distraught, anxious, fearful, whatever it might be, grieving, you don't even have words. You ever been like that, where you're just like, your face planted in the carpet, weeping, and you don't even have words, you don't even know how to pray? That's Romans 8:26. The Holy Spirit intercedes for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. The Holy Spirit will translate our thoughts, intentions, emotion, and heart, translate it to the heart of God, and we don't even have to speak. That's Romans 8:26. This here, praying in the Holy Spirit, I do believe is connected to the gift of the Holy Spirit, and the particular gift of the Holy Spirit mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, having to do with the gift of tongues. Now, not everybody has to receive the gift of tongues. God distributes the gifts liberally as he wills. The gift of tongues is not the evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It is an evidence. The evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is 1 Corinthians 13, which is love. That is the real evidence that somebody is filled with the Spirit of God, when you have the love of Jesus that just drips out of your life, because it's evidence that you've been baptized with the Holy Spirit. But if God has given you that gift, and it can still be exercised today, I don't believe that the gifts petered out with Peter, okay, but that they are still operational today, that if you have that particular gift, the gift of tongues is a language that is always unknown to the one speaking, but it is a known language somewhere, and may even be a known language in heaven, but God knows all languages, and so as he gives that particular gift, that individual is able to pray in a language not familiar to that individual, but it bypasses the limitation of language to connect with the heart of God. What do I mean? Words are a wonderful thing. And words are important, but words are also limited. Have you ever gotten into, I won't say disagreement, just a friendly interaction with your spouse, and in the course of trying to have a conversation, it escalates because you're not connecting with the words. That's not what I meant. That's what I meant was this. No, that is what you said. No, that's what I said. What I said was, and have you ever had one of those? Come on, make me feel better, friends. Come on. And so what happens is you realize the limitation of language. If only my words meant exactly what I believe them to mean, and you could receive them. So words are wonderful, but they also have limitation. And so this particular gift bypasses the limitation of language because it's never known to the individual, and it communes and connects with God. I don't have time to go into that particular gift more than that, but I believe that that's what he's referring to here in this passage of praying in the Holy Spirit. Keep yourselves there, verse 21, in the love of God. And then in verse 22 and 23, he talks about looking out for others. He says, have compassion, verse 22, on some, making a distinction. Now, the NIV says, be merciful to those who doubt. The idea of making a distinction are those who are trying to distinguish between, should I really follow God or shouldn't I? I believe him some days and other days I don't. Is he really real? I think he is, but then other days I don't. And so he says to those of us who are believers, have compassion on those people. Pray for them, walk with them, encourage them, help them, disciple them, mentor them. And he says, but others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating him in the garment defiled by the flesh. He said, there are other people that they got the smell of smoke on their clothes because they're playing with fire. And they're more than just, I'm not sure, is God really real? They're like indulging the flesh and they're living in the world. And he says, go after them as if snatching them from the fire. Go after them, snatching them from the fire. And then here's what God says, this is what he will do. And Jude ends with like this benediction here, verse 24. Now to him, that's the Lord, who is able to keep you from stumbling. Aren't you glad that God's able to help us not stumble? To keep you from stumbling, and to pick us up, by the way, when we do stumble. And to present you faultless not because we're sinless, but because of what Christ has done for us. Our record of sin has been expunged. As far as God is concerned, we can stand faultless before him because we come in the name of Jesus. Present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy to God, our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. And everybody said, amen and amen. Let's pray. Lord, we do worship you and honor you as our Savior. You alone are wise. To you be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Thank you for the words of Jude to remind us that we need to be discerning about false teachers, the distortion of doctrine, the error of liberal theology these days. And we must earnestly contend for the faith, Lord, that we must fight the good fight of the faith. As Paul would write to Timothy in his closing words, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Lord, it doesn't really matter how well we started. What matters is that we might finish well. So help us, Lord, to persevere. And thank you that you are a keeping God who will hold us and help us. You will keep us from stumbling. You will present us faultless in your presence. How grateful we are, Lord, for your work to help us to persevere. When things get difficult, it's a good reminder to us that you're there, Lord, because you're a keeping God. That we might stand before you one day and hear those wonderful words, well done, good and faithful servant. Help us to fight the good fight of the faith for your glory and for your honor and for our ultimate reward. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen and amen. God bless you all.
Christ our captain, for now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given, with shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's light, an army bold whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. Inheritance of nations. Oh, crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror has risen. And as the stone is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, this victory march continues till the day every eye and heart will see. Strength in every strife, give grace for every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful.
Ah.
children and the children.
His favor be upon you
and a thousand generations, and your family and your children
and the children and the children. May his favor be upon you
and a thousand generations,
and your family and your children
and the children
and the children.
Ramatuhan bersamamu
untuk seribu generasi. Keluarga anak kamu,
cucu-cucu anak mereka, kehadapan bersamamu.
Thank you for attending our online service, everyone. We hope you are blessed by it, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Bye-bye.